Running and dreaming. How do I get real? I mean, I try to tell a story that's real, you know, that and I try to tell it in as real a way as possible. So if I'm telling a story about a film collection, I'm using the film collection to tell it, you know. So I guess there's some sort of self-reflexive quality to getting real, you know. It's you can't just talk about it, you have to show it. It has to be it, you know.
And your movie, Dawson City, Frozen Time, was shown in several festivals, like in Italy, the UK, New York, Greece.
Oh, I think it's shown in something like 50 festivals. Yeah, it's been translated into 16 languages. First of all, when I brought the film to Dawson City, the director of the museum said that the first 30 minutes told the history of the Gold Rush better than ever he'd seen it told before, so that was very meaningful to me. Having Kathy Gates and Michael Gates support and endorse my version of the events, that was very important to me. The people were moved by the film. You know, wherever it played has of course been very important to me. The premiere, of course, you don't know what you have until you see an audience's reaction to it, and that was is very positive, both in Venice and in New York. When I am sitting in the audience, there's certain things that people laugh at. They always gasp at the Trump revelation, and like you said, when the headline about the films being dumped in the water, burned on fire, there's always a gasp there, and then people always laugh when Michael and Kathy are talking about their romance, you know, and towards the end. There was nice personal connections. I had a nice conversation with the Frank Barrett, who ran the bulldozer at the beginning. He still lives in outside of Vancouver, so I got to talk to him. And there was a woman who said she was one of the little girls on the float. The Bear Creek Nuggets in the home movie and the parade in 1954, and she was a little blonde girl, so she recognized herself. So things like that have been really nice to hear about. But no, there's no way I could be at every screening, but I try to be at the ones I can, you know. The way of humanity is to dispose, you know. Who knows? I mean, who knows what masterpieces they could have preserved? But it wasn't up to them, you know. Why weren't our libraries? Why weren't the great libraries and cinematheques of the world also making copies of these films and putting them on shelves? So I don't hold the owner of the the D3A Family Theater in Dawson City responsible for saving our family heritage or film heritage. He was just trying to make ends meet, you know, and not get burned down in the process. And well, unfortunately, the D3A was burned down because of a nitrate fire, and as was the Orpheum. The real question is, why was this stuff all printed on a flammable base to begin with? You know, why was film flammable? It should have been made a safety stock as soon as they understood what the repercussions were. This was a deal with the devil that we made for 60 years, you know.
True. And what do you think? I also read that there was no the mystery upon William Desmond Taylor's death.
Yeah.
There was not solved to this day.
Not solved to this day. Yeah, it's one of the great Hollywood mysteries. Who murdered him?
Do you think the production company or who wanted this murder to be? Never be sold.
Oh, it probably involved some actor or actress that was on a payroll in a studio, and so it would have caused a scandal. I'm not exactly sure why this. It's one of the famous unsolved Hollywood mysteries. There have been no fewer than 12 deathbed confessions, people who claim that they were the one who killed William Desmond Taylor. So it's unknown. It would be a great movie, that's for sure. There were men and women who he was involved with who were either jealous of him or betrayed by him or for whatever reason wanted him dead. So he was a very charming guy, so it's a tragedy. But I think what's more intriguing is that this great Hollywood story, a story that's well known by anyone who read Hollywood Babylon or, you know, these, you know, the great gossip stories of the golden age of Hollywood, would be familiar with. And I think it, what would be surprising to people is to learn that this character also worked in the dredge in the Yukon. A dredge is this big machine that pulls up the all the. Yeah, he was a timekeeper for that dredge in Dawson City for 4 years before he went to Hollywood. So I think that was a piece of information that people would be surprised. Most people familiar with old Hollywood would already know the story of his murder.
That's right. And if you were to give some advice to a young filmmaker or a young student at the film school?
What you have to do is you have to be working on a project. It doesn't matter if you don't believe in that project entirely, or if that project's not going that well, you have to be involved in working in it. And you have to find some way that you're either shooting or researching, and that every day you're doing something on it, because that's the only way it goes forward. You can't just sit on it and say, I'm thinking of doing this. And in a way, the archive, whether it's a physical archive that you have or a one on the internet or a virtual archive, your research is what helps you move something forward. It can give you ideas on the project you're working on, or it can give you ideas on a direction that your project could take that's maybe different than the one you conceived of, and it can give you ideas for future projects that are completely different. So I think the only way to keep making new stuff is to have your hands busy. You got to stay in the game.